So today's I'm going to talk to you about how to switch over from the present state of stress. You know, there's stress all around us. So I thought let's talk about stress-free teaching. Let's do something practical rather than, you know, go on talking about what our problems are and how we intend to change it in the future kind of thing. I thought I'll do some real classroom practical stuff with you. And I call it change audaciously, because change is an audacity, okay? If you want to change, you really need to have the will and determination, and you need to take that risk and move forward. Otherwise, we will just be left talking. So we'll do a lot of talking, and we do a lot of talking, but we don't seem to be moving ahead because the movement itself, the doing, is very slow. So today we're going to talk about doing. And again, thank you, RIS, Adarshila Talks, for inviting me. So the COVID crisis, guys, the lockdown dynamics, if you look at it, it's, you know, they say that the real problem with change, my friends, is not with people not accepting new ideas, but with their reluctance to shed the old ones. That's why part of my presentation is going to be about dropping dead habits. So until you actually clean your room, you cannot put new furniture into it. Right? So you can't say I'm going to keep all the old stuff and then I'm going to bring in some more new stuff, which is what happens when we are not willing to take a risk. So what we do is we hang on to all the old stuff. We don't want to change anything, and then we go shopping around for new. And we try to ask ourselves, how can we somehow fit in this new without actually changing any of the old stuff? Now, as we know, if I talk about decorating your room, that's not going to work. You will have to clean out a whole bunch of stuff and clean it up before you can put new things into it. And therefore, it has to be off with the old and in with the new. And that's what I mean by audacity. You need to have the audacity to do that. You need to have the courage to do that and to sustain that for a while, because then you will find that there is light at the end of the tunnel. And there is light very quickly, actually, at the end of the tunnel. It's just the fear that stops us from doing it. So the question is, are we proactive about change or are we reactive to change? Now, all the schools that had already started getting into technology even before this crisis happened were in a much better position than those who started reacting. So those are the proactive ones who decided that the 21st century is on us and technology is going to be the future and started working with technology immediately. The others just said, oh, we are all going on very well. Really, there's no reason to run like this. And now what has happened to them suddenly overnight, there's a reaction. So people were stressed and exhausted, etc. So that's something to think about. Also for the future. Now we are assuming that certain things are going to fall back in place. They might not. So we have to be proactive rather than reactive. So let's see how we can proactively change. The paradox of connections. What something that this virus has taught us is that we are now in a state of isolation and connectivity. It's very strange. It's one of the strangest things that have happened to us. And we were simply not prepared for this. So we are all isolated. We can't touch one another or see one another. And yet we are widely connected. I think I'm more connected now to everyone in terms of using the internet in order to connect than I was ever before. So that's a paradox. Then there is you're alone. And yet there is a huge amount of caring that is happening where people are concerned about you. Available and limited. So everything is available on the net. And yet there is a limitation to what we are able to take. And that is partly because you're not willing to shed what was old. So that availability and limitation is also a paradox. Look, don't touch is applying now. So now when you see somebody, you kind of duck and go to the other side, which is just the opposite of human nature, isn't it? And there is a forced Ubuntu. Ubuntu is this African tribal concept of everyone being connected. And if you are not connected, then you cannot survive. So there is that sense of connectivity. So today I am responsible for everybody else. It's such a such a strange thing that if I am not very responsible, then other people can get the disease. If somebody is not responsible on the street, then that person can put that street into danger. So this kind of understanding of connectivity between human beings is again one of those paradoxes that we did not have before. So there is a whole lot of learning happening in this virus in terms of simply in terms of the way, like, way we live and the way we react. So that's those are lessons that we have to learn. And in future, this whole business that we had of a certain kind of perverse isolation where we did not share anything. We are still not sharing, according to me. We are still very, very slow as far as sharing is concerned. That needs to go away. This virus is teaching us that you cannot be like that. You are responsible for everybody. Everybody is responsible for you. I think that's the best thing that has happened in terms of getting you to physically understand that paradox. So make sure that you have a deep think about that. And it shows you very clearly that sharing and connectivity and taking care of one another is the only way to survive, to be alive. Okay, so that's one. We are coming to technology here. Now, technology, the question to ask is it our friend or our foe? So we are looking at a utopian technological paradise where quite a few years back, we had someone who came up with virtual phones that will happen where you can dial the number on the palm of your hand. So you don't need physical instruments. All you need is the technology, the software. So that sort of technological advances were being given to us in terms of a technological paradise. And then you have, on the other hand, the isolation that technology puts you into. When you actually find that technology is moving you apart, so everybody is on his phone and you have virtual friends and you have a virtual world that you live in, and you're neglecting the real people in your life. So that picture literally demonstrates how each one is in a pocket, almost locked in onto that wall. People are waiting for messages, some people are waiting for real, but everyone seems to be isolated and lonely. And then yet, this time we are connected. So it's a huge paradox, and it's quite interesting when you think about it. It's like an intellectual experiment. Dead habits. Let me take you to dead habits. So if you look at my picture there, we are looking at a young child with lots of fruits in his hand, almost like early spring. And then you have this man, old man, with his books and his theories and stuff that is tradition that's coming down to you from so many generations. They need to be challenged at some stage. We cannot say this is how we have been doing things for the last, God knows, maybe 50, 100 years, and therefore we need to continue it because those are the traditions, those are the values that we bring in. This kind of thinking needs to be scrutinized. So I'm not saying everything that is ancient is rotten and you need to throw it out. But I think when times change, you need to start looking at contexts more closely. So that child, and you'll see that they are turning away from one another. So you can't have a situation where the old man is going to teach that young lad there his all the values in life. And yet they are looking in two different directions, at two different worlds. This is what has happened to us. So let's look at dead habits, timetables. So we've got this huge timetable thing going on where someone once likened schools to prisons. They said you've got bells and you've got timetables and you've got lunch breaks, and then you're all walking in a straight line back into class, and then you're put back into your cages and let out at a certain bell. So that sort of thing. So timetables are something that we need to relook at, especially now when everything is fluid. And even if you're looking at the teacher having done 6 hours or 7 hours in a school, that should not be the way you start looking at time. Okay? So that's something that we need to revisit. Portions. We are all constantly in our head, a syllabus is a portion. And a portion somehow gives me the feeling of a soup kitchen. You know, all of us standing with little bowls and portions being doled out to us. That's not education. That's a sort of It's a ridiculous idea to take something so vivid and alive and protean and dynamic like education and then change it into something that is almost commodifies it. Okay, so therefore portions are out, dead habit. Explanations are out. When you start explaining to children, they stop thinking. This often gives a lot of people huge heartburn when I say this, but I am a person who's completely and totally against explanations. I believe that when you explain something, the mind is in a passive receptive state. When you ask children to think about it and tell you what they found, whatever they found in whatever it is that you were planning to explain, let them give it a shot first. So that's what we need to do. We need to junk explanation, jettison them, right? We need to start thinking about how to question. Question answers, meanings, spellings, this kind of stuff that we do, we mark out portions in brackets, that sort of habits, dead habits. And living in the age of digital miracles, we shouldn't be teaching like we were in the 18th century. Blinkered assessments. Our assessments are all narrow. They are meant to examine small pieces, normally memory, and does not really get into application, does not get into innovation, does not get into deeper values or intentions. So blinkered assessments are something that we should stop. Teacher-driven. Our classes are teacher-driven. They are not child-driven. And there are adult agendas. So an entire education system that is built upon the conveniences of teachers, that is built upon teachers giving children materials to learn only if they know it. Principals telling you that the teachers cannot manage this and therefore it cannot go to the children. There is a certain kind of injustice in that. It's like saying you cannot give that child a wonderful dessert because the teacher doesn't know how to cook. It's like that. Today in the digital age, we really do not need anybody. You will find that there is a lot out there that will help you to burn those agendas and make it more child-centered. And finally, authoritarian and hierarchical systems. What an authoritarian system does when you cannot question people, when you cannot ask them reasons for why they are doing what they are doing, when they are not able to justify in terms of reasoning why certain things are the way they are, then one of the big lessons that we teach children is that the authority is right. Now, all of this will transfer in a big way to the way in which the child looks at the world. So the worldview later on, whether it's a politician, whether it's a person sitting in some place of authority in an office or the boss, all of these, then on the mind of the child, there is a sense of hierarchy, of authority, and of unquestioning obedience. This does not augur well, especially if you have the wrong people at the top. So we know that. Some other serious problems that we have is mass standardized exams. So mass standardized exams, standardization is a terrible thing because it's a one size fits all. It's basically saying all my fingers are of the same size. Now, if I have to make all my fingers the same size, I will have to elongate some and I'll have to chop off the others. So those are extremely painful processes. And that's exactly what is happening with standardized tests. We are not testing children for their aptitudes. We are not letting them show what they know. We are not getting them to look at roads that they might follow tomorrow. There is no variety in terms of how to do, how to present their work. So everybody is studying the same thing, whether you're a person who's doing agriculture in a village, or you're a potter, or you're a fashion designer, or you're a professional. Whatever you are in the variety of professions that we have in this country, you're doing the same exam to call yourself educated. So standardization is something we should not be looking at any more with the kind of tolerance we have given it for so long. And mass. So when I talk about mass, I'm talking about children in the cities, children in the villages, children in the hamlets, children in the tribal areas, all of them getting the same paper, doing the same exam, though their lives are completely diverse. So differentiation needs to happen. The outcomes, if you look at the outcomes of children across the board, there is massive failure. So if you're an English teacher, if you look at the grammar in the 12th, you look at writing, you look at speaking, you look at poetry, you look at comprehension. If you up the standards a little bit, so if you've looked at the CBSE sample paper that they have put up on their website, you will find that a lot of people are quaking in their boots simply because they are not ready to make that kind of sudden change. Now, those changes are not going to happen overnight. They're not even going to happen in the next 2 years, which is what I meant by proactive understanding of where these things will go. Tomorrow, if they dig their heels in and make that change, it's going to be traumatic for a lot of people. So therefore, outcome failures across the board, teaching and tasking. We must move from task giving to teaching. People who are doing that creative writing course with me, in 18 weeks, I have trained about 500-600 teachers now. What we find is that the teaching is not enough, or rather inadequate, or rather the training is highly inadequate. So these are things that are now, for example, I'm almost ready to do a paper on it and say, I've got evidence now to say that our training has failed in a big way. So training and teaching must take place instead of giving tasks. So a teacher then hasn't read anything for a long, long time, doesn't have to read anything for a long, long time, because you have to go and explain, and then you do question answers, and then you give an exam. So the mind of the teacher is in a limbo. Competition and shortcuts. So everyone, including parents, are guilty of this. So competition and shortcuts essentially create, again, a worldview. So the competition doesn't stop with marks. The competition becomes a way of life. So as an adult, you are looking over your shoulder all the time to check how many houses, how many cars, what does the wife look like, what are the children doing in school, then what are the grandchildren like. So it's like an endless misery of competition that you build when you start the competition in school. So competitive, we are looking at collaborative. We are not looking at competitive. They are exact opposites. Jargon consumers. So if you look at advanced education, you'll find people are into terminology. Terminology, anyone can use terminology. Now I can say, oh, differentiation, integration. I can spew words, but they are words. If I ask you, show me evidence, show me behaviors of integration in your school or of differentiation, you should be able to table it. Only then can you use, you are not a jargon consumer, you're actually using that jargon in order to promote your children's well-being. The foreign hand, this is another one. So we bring stuff from outside and we simply impose it on children. There's no question of asking, are the aspirations of these children the same as the children in that country? Is our economic status, is our welfare schemes, are they all the same? Do we live in the same way? So without that, don't take something from abroad and then just start pushing it into India. Because those are things that where you find a lot of jerks and a lot of inconsistencies. The parent trap, as I said, it's all adult conveniences. It's all about the adults. It's about making sure that so you will have ambitious parents, you have teachers who are looking again, as I said, at their own convenience. Do I have enough questions to ask for the first term, the second term? How am I going to correct all these papers? It's constantly the me talk. So we've stopped being child-centered. Government controls are another thing which we are all aware of. And then there is a psychology of scarcity. So you don't have enough colleges. So everyone is on a rat race. Now, these are some of our serious problems. The reason I'm saying this is we need to jettison some of these problems. And we're going to talk about what are the things we can do to actually make this happen. Because there are some things that are beyond our control, but there is a lot that is within our control. Trust me. So let's see what they are. So we start at the beginning. Let's start with the pre-primary. The biggest problem that we have is that we are starting, you know, they say that, well, if you start well, it's half done. It's just the opposite. We are not starting properly. We are starting badly. And how are we starting badly? By not recognizing the absolute genius of the pre-primary child. So if you look at the child's progress from 0 to 1, the progress that a child makes is far greater than any other time in his entire life. So the child is active, is playful, is curious, is imaginative, is creative, is spontaneous, is innocent, honest, trustful. There is every beautiful value and virtue is present in that child. And that is our true nature. If you look at adults, that's exactly my nature. I am playful. I want to have fun. I am social. I want to collaborate with people. This is my real nature. I don't want to sit in a room alone and work. That is stressful. In fact, people will die if you isolate them like that. And yet, when we examine them, they are all on their own. So we need to start thinking about how discordant our reality is from the kind of ideals that we have espoused. It's tragic. So the pre-primary child is ready to speak, is a genius, taught himself or herself to speak when he or she was 2 or 3 years old, which is brilliant, did not have any tutors. If you gave them a pizza that is slightly lesser than the brothers, they would know, without knowing the math of shapes and sizes and everything else that we are trying to feed them, they would know that they have been shortchanged. So that child has got a native genius that we do not recognize. And we are making them do something that is completely alien again, where the physically, the mind and the body are not ready for a whole bunch of exercises. That's what we are making this child do for 3 years. The child in grade 1 or 2, if he's not speaking the language of the curriculum, okay, you are in trouble. So this is something that cannot be, you cannot wish it away. The child, as I said, if you look at your most primal painters and you look at this drawing of this little child, you'll find all the qualities that I told you. There is a huge amount of freedom with which the child operates. Does not care about social comment and criticism. So that sort of kid we take and we mold it into a person who is now scared of authority, who's constantly seeking approval, who has been told that the line is not straight, it's crooked. So if that spontaneity is lost, then we are looking at trouble all the way, because then you're going swimming against the tide. So this is self-explanatory. So you're looking at how do children who are 2 years old know the grammar of language. That's what I spoke about. Why should I learn to spell when they spell check? Why should I study algebra? How does the knowledge of latitude and longitude affect me? So the whys of learning have not been explained. Why should I read about dead people? These are pertinent questions that have not been answered. And they have not been answered because pedagogically, you are teaching is at such a superficial level that we do not tap any of these areas. They are uncomfortable questions. But they are questions that are absolutely necessary, and our pedagogy should suit the way in which these questions can get answered. That's what we need to do. So let's see how we can do it. So stress-free facilitation. Now, pattern cognition is something that I have been teaching the teachers in the course. Everything that you do has a pattern. Now, pattern in mathematics is something that we recognize instantly, because that entire subject is built on patterns. So we understand that perfectly well. But we don't see it in the other subjects. So let me tell you the story of disadvantaged learners that we once taught in a school where I was their consultant, and we looked at the study of civilization. So these children were in a state of failure, took them under my wing, showed the teacher how to do one civilization using a mind map. Well, just one civilization. There are six civilizations to do. So we did one civilization, showed them how to work it, brought it down to its essence, brought it down to its lowest denominator in terms of understanding. The how-tos. How do you study a civilization? What are the most important things you look for? You need a timeline. You need a river. You need to look at what was the landscape around it. What sort of trade did they do? So we looked at parameters of civilization. So we did one. The second one was done by them with the teacher helping. The third one they did in pairs, and then they went away for a Diwali holiday where they finished all their three other civilizations in the book on their own with their mind maps, came back. When I went back in October, those children were actually comparing civilizations and they were disadvantaged learners. So I'm telling you, it can be done. We have a tendency to stretch that book till the end of the year. So you slowly chug along. It's painful. And after studying minerals and, trade and everything in one civilization, then you're coming to the next one and the next one, the next one. By the fourth civilization, the child has neither the parameters and he is confused about who traded what where. So this sort of illogical teaching is what is our bane. Six poems in 30 minutes, grade four. So how do you do that? Again, you teach how to read a poem. See, the how-tos are critical. If we do not teach them how to read a poem, if you're going to take a poem and go line by line on that poem, what will happen is that children then know only that poem. And if you go to another one, they're looking up at you again for help. But if I show you how to read it, if I say, I'm going to ask you to read it and tell me what it's about, what are the cluster of words that you find, are they happy words or sad words, where is the imagery, I'm going to show you how to pick out devices in the poem. Even if I teach you four things, I can then give you six poems and ask you to do what I just taught you. Because you know the devices. You know whether they are happy words or sad words. You know that it's about a rabbit, it's about a dog, it's about a giraffe. You can do that much. Now that is self-help. How many papers are you taking home? Four. So your work is less stressful. This 30 minutes is available to you throughout the year. So if I have done 36 poems, the children in that grade four are much smarter than somebody who does six poems throughout the year, sporadically every 2 months, and then gives them tests and then takes 40 papers home to correct. It's just drudgery. Why would you not work like this is something that I cannot understand. That's why I'm saying you have to get the old furniture out. You cannot continue to read and explain poems and then try to push this in somehow. So that won't work. If you do it like this, like the children finish their civilizations by the end of November, it'll all be over. And then I said, you've got another 4 months to revise it. There's no question of anybody failing in that class. And they didn't. See? The world is your book. As the bard says, tongues in trees, books in brooks, sermons in stones, and good everywhere. So it's not just the teacher is just one piece. That book is just one piece. If we are going to take on the onus, like Gurukul teachers, we say we are the only repositories of knowledge, then what's going to happen to us? What's going to happen to us is stress, right? But if everything around you speaks to the child, whether it's a beggar on the road, whether it's his grandma, whether it's something on the net, whether it's a person sitting in Japan whom he connects to, today we connect with the entire world, isn't it? So therefore, the world should be your book. The win-win of inquiry. If you espouse inquiry, inquiry, don't make a song and dance about it. It's not an IB concept, excuse me. It's normal human behavior to inquire is something that you should do. If someone turns up at your door and says, I want work in your house, you will inquire. And that's exactly what you do. If someone presents me with a piece of history, I'm going to inquire. I need to ask, is this correct? From where did this come? Who wrote it? Did he have an intention to influence me? I need to ask those questions. That is inquiring. You don't need to go and pay 6 lakhs of rupees anywhere to do that. You can do it in the most humble school, SSC school, right? Now, SSC teachers have taken upon themselves to say, oh, we are so miserably low. We can't do anything. That's just a block. It's a mindset. You need to break out of it. The minute you take these restraints out, you are free. Choose books that have skills. Don't take textbooks for 8 lessons and 12 poems and say, they are easy. We'll make an easy paper and give it. You'll suddenly get hit like this when somebody on top changes that paper for whatever reason. They may not be changing it for any altruistic reason. They may be changing it for pure political reasons. But like the CC, when the CC came in, there were seismic waves all over the place. So we should not get caught on the wrong leg. Okay? Remember, content is everywhere. You don't really need content. If you tell me I'm going to do Mohammad Ghazni, I'm going to take my cell phone and Google the guy. I don't need content from anywhere. What I need is skills. Now, if I find 6 Ghaznis there, I need to know how to evaluate which one is the best. Then I need to know how to evaluate Ghazni. What parameters do I need for in Ghazni?
Yes? Excuse me, ma'am. We had lost you for a minute there. So if the last point, if you could just repeat.
Did you hear the inquiry point?
Yes.
Yes. So I was talking about choosing books for skills. Okay?
Yes.
So when you choose, because content is everywhere. So it's in your phone. Whatever you want to read, no matter whether it's science or history or geography, you'll find content on your cell phone. What you will not find is skills on how to do it. So if I'm going to give you, let us say, an emperor, or I'm going to give you some geography where I say that's your, let's study Mexico. From where do I do it is the question. Am I going to read it line by line from one text? Am I going to look at it and say, I have certain questions that I want to ask about Mexico. I want to ask, what is the landscape of Mexico? Just the landscape. Is it on a latitude which is cold or warm or temperate? What is it? Does it have mountains? Does it have a river? If I know these things, I can logically conclude that there are certain kinds of products coming from that place. So it becomes now a logical journey as opposed to reading that book, marking out brackets for portions that I'm going to ask you in the next examination. And then, of course, I have to ask you those portions because I marked them out. Instead, then I can give you another country. I will not give you Mexico. I will give you another country. Let me give you Greece. And let me give you its parameters and ask you to guess. What sort of animals, what sort of flora, fauna, guess what sort of stuff they would be doing there. That is an intelligent question. And that's what we need to train our children for, because we don't have to worry about Mexico. It is there on the cell phone. Content is everywhere. That skill that I just talked to you about does not exist. That's what a teacher is for. And you do that with 2 countries, every country in the world is now available to that child because pattern cognition happened. Empathy is the crown jewel of all virtues. Please remember, it is not about, education is not about the head. Education is about the heart. And more importantly, education is about the hand. What you do with it is the most important thing. If you're going to use your education for consuming for yourself, and buy innumerable clothes and houses and cars or whatever, if that is going to be the way your life is going, then you can be sure that you're going to end up like some of those celebrities that you hear who are so miserable that they kill themselves. Now you need to ask yourself, what's wrong? What's happening? Why is that happening? See, there is no deeper questioning when these things happen with our children. We're not talking to them. We're not asking them, why did that happen? what went wrong with those people? What, therefore, how do you want to change your value picture now? Those kind of questions are not being asked. We're not choosing stuff for them. We're not looking at poetry where we have poems and we have lessons and we have stories, short stories like this, that actually mirror and reflect what is happening in your society. The Ivy League essay expects reflective thinking. I was talking again to my course about reflective thinking, teaching them how reflective thinking should be done and how it's absolutely critical. So when you go to an Ivy League, the entrance to that Ivy League happens only with a make or break essay. Okay, the make or break essay either lets you in or keeps you out. It's not dependent on how beautifully you write, what is your turn of phrase. They're not interested. They're interested to know whether you engage with life. So even if you write about very banal experiences, like maybe going to your village and meeting your grandmother, just such a commonplace thing. A lot of children do it during the summer. If they've asked you to write about something that commonplace, and if you then can reflect deeply on that event, if you can talk about how what you saw in that village and what kind of conversations you had and what sort of attitudes you had before you went there and how you were able to compare it with your own life in the city and what did you find wanting, what did you find advantages, what was the life of your grandmother like, and how you might want to look at an illiterate old lady who lived a hard life and actually see heroism in her life. You know, if you don't talk like this, there's no reflection. You just went, had a great holiday, you ate mangoes and jackfruit and you came back. They're not interested in that sort of thing. They want people who are going to make a change in this world. Those are the people they let into their portals. And I'm saying, do it in your country. Don't wait for Ivy Leagues. Do it in grade 7 in your schools. Because then it becomes a way of life in all writing. So whenever I write, I'm thinking of what deeper reflection do I need on this event. Like how we used to have the moral of the story, which was a very thin way to do things. But if you have what is the reflection in the story, what is the reflection in this event, you will get real thinkers and doers at the end of that education. And that is character building. So stress-free facilitation.
Ma'am, I would like to add to this, if you allow me.
Yes, of course.
So I'm experiencing this firsthand with my daughter now looking for college admissions abroad. And we have checked these essay prompts on UCAS. I have just typed also. I would like people to look for that. It's a common app. You can simply write common app essay prompts also. Common app, APP. Mm. And these are such wonderful prompts. And you would see that the students are not being taught to think that way. They are essays. And they are so different from the essays our teachers teach in the school. So teachers must definitely see that and introduce in the school those kind of essays.
Jaya, you don't need, it's not the topic. So you know the kind of topic that I actually discussed with some of the teachers who sat back with me, and I'm sure some of the teachers from your school were there that day. There are topics like slipping on a banana peel. If I broke a table, how would I react? I don't like my host mother's food. What should I do? They're that kind of, they're banal topics. And we had such deep discussions. So if you ask them, they'll tell you. But that's the depth that we are looking at. That's the depth that they're looking for. So from ordinary things, ordinary events, what is the greater wisdom that you can glean? That's what they're looking for. And that can be trained in our children. If we build solid citizens like this, you tell me who can touch us. And I'm not talking about other countries. I'm talking about our own country where we seem to be slaves to certain people who are riding roughshod all over. So that will not happen. That is happening because the authoritarian culture is what is coming in. And they are terrified to raise their voice. We are all terrified to raise our voices. We become cowards. We cannot have that kind of thing happening for the future generation. So therefore, reflective thinking is the way to go. I'm just giving you certain snippets of what you can do. So don't say I need, oh, the government controls everything, the managements control everything. No, you control everything because you are in that classroom. And if you do work like this, nobody is going to complain because they'll see the value of it instantly. Children, parents, everybody will see the value. They will not say go back to the old system and give them brain dead question answers. No one will. So don't talk, don't benchmark, just do. We talk a lot. There was someone who said to me, I want to benchmark your students. I said, no, don't benchmark my students. You send your teachers to me. When I do the course, I'll benchmark them. Let me first benchmark the teachers. So you see what I'm saying? This kind of thing, gather two, three people from abroad, they come and then they do something. Where are we going? In the classroom, I want to know what is happening. I don't want panels sitting and telling me how to reinvent education. I want to know what is going to happen in that classroom tomorrow. I have given you real changes that you can do just now in that previous slide. Now, if you look at this slide, you've got a whole bunch of tools. You've got your syllabus in the middle. I put Africa, Mauritius. You can put anything that you want, whatever your syllabus is. And then you've got skills on the other side. Higher order thinking skills, 21st century skills. That's what you've got there. Now you shut your eyes and just jab your finger in three places. And whatever comes up, take it. That is your task. And I'm telling you, you'll do very well. Because you've got excellent skills. You can add more, you can subtract a bit, but don't get into the blah and banal kind of tools that we are using now. And you'll find that you get beautiful stuff. Give choices to children. Everybody need not do the same thing. Let four groups do four different things. It's a rich class. You cannot at this point say everybody should do the same thing because then how can we judge them? How can the marks be fair? What is unfair is what we are doing now, where the child does not seem to have any thoughts in their heads, where they don't seem to have an opinion, where they do not know how to defend their points of, they don't have a point of view to begin with. So that is what is unfair. Unfair is not giving choices and allowing students to have a certain volume of exposure. If you don't have exposure, you won't get it. So if you look at those multiple choice questions in that CBSE, you've got words, you might have words like, let us say, repugnant, revoked. Kids will see stars because those are not words that are common in their usage. So the minute you jump it up like that, so if you, that is the 10th, I can imagine what the 12th is going to be. And do not think that it is not possible, because go and take a look at your railway exams, go and take a look at your NEET and all kinds of these elimination exams that you have. And they are horrendously difficult because they are trying to eliminate you. So this might well be an elimination task. However, what I'm basically trying to tell you is that you need to be prepared. You need to be proactive rather than reactive. So look at the richness of this. You're asking for skills. You're asking for social values, original ideas, problem solving, map work, research, debating and discussing. There is writing. There can be speaking also. So add the skills that are going to happen in the workplace, skills that are going to come in handy when children leave school, because that is when life begins. Life is not the 10th and 12th standard examination. It happens after that, unfortunately. If it happened, ended there, I'd be very happy. I'd say, okay, go for it, go for the 98. But if you went to an interview and said, I didn't win, nobody will forgive you and say you came from the SSC, and nobody will say you're from IB, or perhaps you are right. Nobody will say that. So let's not fool ourselves. Collectively, we've been fooling ourselves. Analytical, critical, lateral, and creative thinking. The future belongs to the thinker. We don't need content. I'm telling you, you've got it on the cell phone. Nobody will ask you a question like, when did Akbar rule? There'll only be some brain-dead Indian exams that will ask that. But nobody will ask you what was the rule reign of Akbar from where to where. They might tell you who were the contemporaries of Akbar during that time. And we don't know who the contemporaries were because we don't think like that. We don't study like that. Because when we are doing Akbar, we are just going linear on that history. We're not looking at what happened across the world when he was ruling. So we cannot compare him to anybody else. We cannot then say that we were such an advanced civilization during that time. He had the highest GDP in the world. Because we can't see the other parts of the world. We're not even looking at them. Because we don't, that's not our portion. That's not our syllabus. There is something so downpulling, so miasmic about the way in which we choose content, the way in which we choose, you choose any content, but you can laterally go forward and start looking at different things. So analytical thinking is basically your linear deductive reasoning, your sequential reasoning, understanding cause and effect. That's what you're looking at when you look at analytical thinking. We are normally looking at analytical thinking in our education. What we don't do is critical thinking, which the government is very ambitiously trying to push in. Let me tell you, critical thinking is all about the truth. How do you know something is true? Where did you find it? What is the source? Why should we believe that source? So if there was something, some action taken, who was harmed? Who decides? Who made that decision? These are the kind of hard questions. Now, if you have somebody who is afraid of certain histories, you cannot have critical thinking because it will scare them. Because you can't face yourself. Critical is, I have to denude myself and I have to look at myself in the face and say, I did some terrible things and I have to admit it. See, it's about courage, critical thinking. Can we do it? Now, in the name of critical thinking, you can't do something that's hodgepodge, something that's superficial, and then tell everybody, oh, we're doing critical thinking. This is what we do. We fool ourselves. Lateral thinking, on the other hand, is where you think laterally. Again, lateral is like this. So you're looking at it like this. So if you look at the hand, drawing the hand by M.C. Escher, what you're seeing there is an imagination that you might probably never have had, right? You look at that last picture where there is a cutout of a squirrel on a back black paper and kept on top of a man's mustache. So the mustache becomes a part of the squirrel's tail. Now what happens with laterality is that you'll have to take a lot of risk and you'll have to see whether it works or not. Lateral thinking is serendipity. Lateral thinking is design, is innovation. It's all about this create, and from that you will get creative thinking. Creative thinking is a sort of madness. So when you make something that is creative, the poet, the artist, all of these people are slightly crazy. They are, as someone said, they are crazy, but not crazy enough to go to a mental hospital. They are crazy enough to come back. They are crazy, all right. So that's creative thinking. When you talk of anything that you do, it needs to have a different perspective. It needs to have a new way of thinking. So the impact, the influence of things, these are the big pictures that we have, and we need to have. You can do this with ordinary lessons, by the way. You don't need to have any heavy duty stuff coming from any foreign university, trust me. The most humble lesson in your book can be put to analytical thinking, can be put to critical thinking, definitely, can be laterally compared to other things. And you can do something very creative with it when you join it with something else, when you synthesize, what they call synthesize. You will find that in all this, you need training. Now, if you are not going to train and you're going to sit shy, first of all, you don't have trainers. Then when someone offers you training, you don't take it. And then when you take it, a workshop is a waste of time, by the way, because you don't engage with it. What I found with the work, with the course that I'm doing, is that people cried and screamed and yelled and but they finished it and they are feeling good about it because they have understood it thoroughly. So the doing, guys, is critical. Workshop is a feel good. You listen to somebody for 4 or 5 hours and you walk out of the door and say, I got it. When you get a paper to do, that's when you realize, oops, I haven't got it. So you need to train. methods need to change. We are looking at something called BFC, which is volume, frequency, and context. So how do we allow children to retain core learning? So when you teach them something, let's say, so what's my core learning? My core learning is not Mexico. My core learning is not Greece. My core learning is the parameters on which I judge those countries. So if you give me a country, I'm going to ask first, what's the landscape? On which latitude and longitude it is? The minute I get that, I know what the weather is. If I know there's a mountain there, I know this is what is going to happen. So I have understood my landscapes very well. And then if it's cold, then I know people will dress in a certain way. There's a mountain, there must be goat and sheep. See, this is how I'm going to work it out. Now that's a frequency question. I need to ask that several times. How are you going to judge a country? How are you going to judge an emperor? How are you going to judge a story? What are you looking for in a poem? I need to ask those questions and you need to tell me. That's all. I don't need to have individual, you know, miserable ways in which to study and memorize and throw it up in some exam and then forget all about it after that. Context is very important. In what context? We live in a particular context. Everybody didn't live in this context. People lived in different contexts where values changed. What are the values that were universal? What are the things that will change and what are the things that are going to be permanent? This is wisdom. If we never take a story and think like this, then the child will just be consuming the story for an exam and then passing it up, and it's as good as not doing it. They might as well have played football. So, talking of football, by the way, if you've seen a football coach ever teaching, you'll find that the guy will dribble, he will pass the ball, he'll train them with small skills, and then he'll put it together in a match. In a small match, and then go to the state level, and then go to play a big tournament. They're not going to simply straight away say, okay, here is something, and now guys, in 200 words, write this. Because what we are doing is, as soon as we finish dribbling, we are sending them for the tournament. So beware of this kind of, just go back and reflect on how you teach and what you teach, and the answers better be very good, otherwise change. So context, autonomous learner, as I said, how-tos and a lot of practice with it. So after you teach them the how-tos, let them do all the countries. So in your class, if there are 30 children, divide them into 6 batches and give them one country each. So using that how-to parameter, they're now going to, in groups, look at 6 countries. And they're going to write, they'll write a letter to their friend talking about what fun they had when they went for a holiday. They'll need all the facts of that country. So they're learning geography, they're doing English, they're doing teamwork. It's all brilliant. And you've spent about 30, 40 minutes doing it. Let them do it imperfectly. Imperfection is good, because it gives us an opportunity to look at where the gaps are. It allows them to do more practice because there's more time. This is how you do it. Even if you did those 6 countries to death, they are not likely to remember it next year. You can be sure. But if I ask the how-to question 12 times, all the kids know how to do a country, and that's all I need. Because all the stuff that you need, we are not sitting in the 19th century. We are in the digital age. We've got it on the net. Using energy of large numbers, like I said, the Diwali homework that I had given kids, and once when I did a 10th grade, I did it for a year. So when they went for Diwali, I took 40 topics that are likely to come in the 10th, and I told them, mind map it for ideation. So I gave them how to ideate. And all of them did 40, each one of them did one topic and came back. And then we passed it around the class, had more ideas. Then I looked at it, we ring-bound that book, and they had 40 mind maps. They were prepared for that exam. The Diwali holiday was beautifully spent. Each one did just one mind map. They didn't waste their whole holiday writing. What would you have done? You would have given them an essay to write for Diwali. They would have cursed you and written that essay, and you would have taken 40 papers home to correct. and the children would have got one topic. So have a good think about what I'm saying. Energy in good numbers, creativity and original thinking. We talked about the flipped classroom. Let the children teach. After you have done two things, everything is theirs. The field is theirs. Then don't go anywhere near that board. Don't go. They will make the PPTs. They'll do the whole works. I'm talking about your middle school. Five upwards, all of them can flip the classroom. Flip the classroom. Throw the book into the dustbin in 4 or 5 months. You should not do more than that. Because after that, everything in the book, they will do. And you will only come in to facilitate and ask for certain things. But did you notice that? What about this? This is what you should do. Again, let them go back to the drawing board and think. Reward the values you cherish publicly. So we want honesty, we want punctuality, we want integrity, we want justice, we want empathy. Are we giving anybody medals for these during a school day? Are we giving them medals? Are we giving them stars? Are we kind of holding these children up and saying, this is what we cherish? We are shy to give them prizes for these things. Prizes only go for mathematics and English and geography. Have a good think about that. Because the minute you start rewarding those things publicly, you're actually changing society. Synchronous and asynchronous, forever we should do this now. So then even if you open, don't crowd your school up. Have it every alternate day, children coming in. Give them synchronous work, give them asynchronous work. And that's it. It'll be brilliant. You don't really need to go back to what you were doing before because it was unhealthy. Okay? And if you work like this, it'll be fascinating what will happen. This SUPW thing, the social consciousness. When I was a young girl, I remember we had something called Kari Kamai. So we used to go to other people's houses and sweep their floors. And they would say, but beta, don't sweep, don't do. And we used to say, nay, nay, we have to sweep. And then you have to give us, they'd give us those 5 paise and 10 paise and we collect it and give it for charity. But somehow that vanished. And then in its place came something called SUPW, where the whole thing was wasted in people teaching each other how to knit and sew and things like that. Became a free period where you did whatever you wanted. The IB, I think, has got something called CAS, which is a community service thing, and creativity, activity, service, all of these big names. I really don't know how much of this is actually being translated into children becoming socially conscious. So social consciousness is a very important thing. We need, if you have any of these things, take it very seriously and start doing some real work, you know, like changing parts of the community. And that's how children grow. Whenever they go there, they need to reflect again. That reflection cannot be thrown away. Can't just go there and sit there and come back. Get it done with English. So I'm sorry. Yeah, I did this. So, the last one is that triple whammy. Choices, integration, collaboration. You keep these three things in mind, guys, and let me tell you, you're done. If in every question you put these three elements in, you'll have rich HOT questions, you will have a rich classroom, you will be able to integrate a lot of things, you'll get your work done very fast, your children will become smarter and smarter. It's the Mool Mantra. Examples of a thinking curriculum, how media aware are you? I'm just giving you a gist of questions. Paradise Lost and Bhagavad Gita, essays on death. Was Vidura a party to the provocation of Dhritarashtra? Is the incarceration of Anne Frank better than the children who ran in the open during World War II in the Silver Sword? Satyagraha is a fight for truth. Whose truth? Transactional analysis, the science and conflict of relationships, euphemisms, connotations, subliminal messages, psychological profiles of Dracula, Mr. Hyde, and Frankenstein. All of these are from Empowering English. Now, of course, you will, if you say, I don't know what this is, you do have a manual, but you really need to read it and give it to your children. If I don't know, it doesn't matter. They don't know. We are creating a future where adults are constantly going to say, I don't know. They will need this when they do what we call a group discussion, when they want that $100,000 rupee job, right? Or whatever, big job. And there are 20 people, that's when they'll need all this. Who's going to give it to them at that point? So you need to have a good think. Don't run away from rigor. Start embracing rigor. And if you don't know, it doesn't matter. It's a child's flip the classroom. They will do it. This is eighth grade. They'll do it. Don't get into it. There is a net to help them with everything. Don't ask for what is the right answer, what is the wrong answer. As I said, imperfection is good. Your supervisor, for example, in a classroom, good classroom, will ask, how many skills are you teaching in physics this year? That's a question. Have you transferred concepts to skills? And show me how you have transferred concepts to skills. What have children innovated in your class? Have they done anything? That's a question. Have they made anything new? Have they thought about something? Is there a hypothesis that they have produced after learning physics? Anyone produced any apps? We are living in the world of apps. Small children as little as 12 are producing apps. Machine prototypes. So they don't have to create things that are running. They need to create ideas. That's my point here. So this is the conversation the supervisor and the physics teacher needs to have in a school. Not how many chapters, which chapter are you giving for the first term exam? Oh, you're doing the third chapter, then you do the fourth. This is not the way we talk. This is ridiculous. Any social ideas floated and practiced? So everything must bind back into a social idea, into a social consciousness, right? An awareness. Innovation, social consciousness, problem solving. This is your science that you should be doing. If you look at that horse that is there, you'll find that it's got some strange things that are coming out, you know, squares. It's inspired by pixelation. The pixelation that happens when you have a low internet, that is what has inspired this sculpture. It's brilliant. So there is absolutely, there is art sitting everywhere, right? So I'm coming to my COVID report card. So what did I do? What did it teach me? This virus. So 2 months, I must have sat doing nothing, wondering what to do, where is it going, etc. Probably housework, worked myself on many things which I couldn't do because I'd never done it before. And then I started 2 creative writing courses, one for primary and one for secondary. And I did 3 batches of that in 18 weeks. Training is the key. That was massive. That's massive work. 3,600 scripts I have read, 600 teachers I've trained in 18 weeks. Somebody was asking me, Miss, how are you like this? You and I must have had the same kind of training, which is true. But I said to her, you wrote 6 scripts. I read 3,600 scripts. That's a difference. I did what is called a collective feedback. That's the other thing. Micro-correcting things to death. You can never do it. Because what would they have got back? They would have got back their papers with 20 corrections in red and felt miserable about themselves. They would have had 6 papers back. In a collective feedback where I curated some of the good stuff, where I took some of the average and struggling stuff and corrected it for them, just a few, where I gave them a lot of advice on where they went wrong. Do you know how many pages they have taken home? In 6 papers, they have taken 150 pages of feedback. Where is 150? Where is 6? You see the richness? It's got resources. If you ask a hot question, each of them will probably get about 30 hot questions, 50 hot questions. It's just ridiculous, the volume. They're like, we don't need anything else. We've got enough things for 2 years. Just by sharing. Sharing is so poor that it is tragic what we are doing to ourselves. Don't share anything. Don't even tell anybody if something good is happening. It's a basket of crabs. We cannot do this to ourselves. Teacher behavior and ability when tested is something that I noticed. How do teachers behave? When they are tested, what are their abilities? So I have a lot of information. I can write a paper. I have enough raw materials to write 4 books because I did that course. Now I'm looking at something and I'm saying, what are the various, look at the number of things I have done in 18 weeks. This is important. I started teaching my maid. There she is down there. I started teaching her to read and write. Completely illiterate. It took me some 2 months to realize that the poor thing has a learning difficulty. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable in an adult that you can have a sharp woman, mind you, intelligent, but has a learning difficulty. Now, it's taught me to empathize more with everyone with learning difficulty because I've had that experience. I've been teaching my grandson. He's down there. He's 10. I've been teaching him for the past 6 months. Amazing. He can't write to save his skin. If he was in India, probably they would have put him in some remedial program. Can't write. But I made him do small notes. He's an audiovisual learner. Now, you need to understand what kind of learner he is. The amount that kid has done, we did things like Animal Farm. I write about it on my FB sometimes. People come and say, you know, do you want to do classes for all children? But it's not about classes. It's about understanding the kid and saying, oh, I can't put that maid of mine and this boy in the same class. It would be disastrous. You need to understand their strengths and play up to it. But if you play up to the strengths, it's the sky is the limit. What I've done with that child is absolutely miraculous. All, where is he sitting? Not with me. He's in New Zealand, 10,000 miles away, on the net. So don't tell me in 1 hour. 1 hour is all that I teach. But my way of looking at it, I'm not finishing a portion, see. But if you look at the portions that he has done, you cannot kiss the hem of what that kid has done in 6 months. And that's what you need. You need that volume. Where is it going to? Now, if you give a test suddenly, half of it may be forgotten. But even the half that is remembered is huge. And if you look at that half that is remembered or the other half that is just about, you know, sitting at the edge of memory, even if you look at it like that, what you'll find is that when it blossoms after 5 or 6 years, you'll wonder how this kid happened. Because there is a hibernation time in learning. You can't just push everywhere. Oh, why don't you give him 10 math sums? Why don't you make him read this? This sort of, you know, frenzy that we whip up on children is terrible. So sharing and feedback, Tara's story, Atreya's story. I joined an art class and all this art stuff that I'm showing you is from that art class. I love it. If you guys want the art videos of this amazing man called Ganga Sir, you must tell me and I will, I think he charges $350 for that, for a video. But it's gold, absolutely gold. He talked to us about this Girls in the Storm. So if you look at that picture there, it's about this photographer, a very famous photographer who takes models to Africa. And he dresses up in these clothes and he sets them against these acacia trees and the Maasai warriors and absolutely spectacular fashion photography. And they heard that there was a storm coming that day. And then what happens to people is when they hear there's a storm, they run because it's cameras, very expensive equipment, and people will advise you, you know, just storm, desert storms are terrible. What he did was he decided to stay. He said, no, let's shoot in the storm. It's a ridiculous decision to take. And then you can, in that picture, you can see that wind coming in. See, it's getting hazy already. So he started capturing it from the black clouds to the oncoming storm where the clothes are just starting to fly. And the last one is of a girl standing there and her toes are curled with the tension of that storm. And he shot in that storm. What it produced for the world was the only, possibly the only photograph that you will ever find in the fashion photography world that was caught in a storm. So that's the, it's without, it is matchless, the value, right? So that was a great, very, very, you know, therapeutic experience of learning from a really, really good, very down to earth, excellent teacher. So this is my COVID report card. So that's what you should ask yourself, what did I do? How did I influence people? What did I get for myself? You know, for my own soul, what did I do? For my own soul, I'm doing the art course. So therefore, I think we need to have a balance in life. We need to start saying, what are very many things that I, and don't think that this is the only thing I'm doing. I binge watch Netflix. Whenever I can, you need to snatch life. Literally, time has to be snatched out of life. So I do. I binge watch. I sleep for 18 hours. It's not that you don't do those things. But in everything, you need to have a certain balance and a strong mind. If you follow somebody and if you're following and following and following and cribbing and cribbing and cribbing, it's a miserable life. This is another one of those art ones. I'm so fascinated. This is called a sky painter. So you stand between buildings and you see a stretch of the sky, and then the guy paints a picture. See, it's of this woman with hair and she's sitting there and those are her legs. So he's filled that space, negative space, with a picture. It's absolutely fascinating. This was protest photography where a man who had visited Africa, the same spot in Africa, probably 50 years ago, had shot this rhinoceros in that environment. And when he went back to it, this is what he found. So he pulled out the picture of that rhinoceros, he blew it up, and then he put it there to show you what was lost in the name of development, in the name of modernism, or modernity. What you have lost. You've lost your animals, and you put people into terrible poverty and into terrible squalor. So it's a without saying a single word, the photograph speaks. So I'm having a great time on that art course. If you guys want those videos, please do write to me. So I come to the end of my presentation. I hope I've not done too badly on time. The invitation by Oriya Mountain Dreamer. This is the last part of his poem. He says, I want to know if you can see beauty even when it is not pretty every day. And if you can source your own life from its presence. I want to know if you can live with failure, yours and mine, and still stand at the edge of the lake and shout to the silver of the full moon, yes. It doesn't interest me to know where you live or how much money you have. I want to know if you can get up after the night of grief and despair, weary and bruised to the bone, and do what needs to be done to feed the children. It doesn't interest me who you know or how you came to be here. I want to know if you will still stand in the center of the fire with me and not shrink back. It doesn't interest me where or what or with whom you have studied. I want to know what sustains you from the inside. When all else falls away, I want to know if you can be alone with yourself and if you truly like the company that you keep in the emptiness, in the empty moment. That's what it is. So I think it kind of encompasses everything about what you should be. At the end of the day, this is what we want for our children. To be alone and in that empty moment, to be at peace. Not to go and slit your wrists, not to hang from a fan, not to look whether it's... There are mundane things to be done, even if you're in grief and despair. That resilience, that empathy is what you need to give children. And if we do that, I think we've been very, very successful teachers. So guys, thank you very much for listening to me. Now I shall stop sharing so that I can see all of you. It was lonely out here, not seeing a single person.
We were there throughout with you, ma'am. There's no chance that ma'am. You know, you will lose or we will lose this opportunity. People have been writing such appreciation for this session, and they have taken a lot of key takeaways from this session. So thank you for making it possible. And the interesting idea of the COVID report card, let us take it as our home assignment and let's share with ma'am if possible.
COVID report card. That's
wonderful.
That's a defeat COVID.
I think teachers would be interested in attending your training sessions, those who are not from Mumbai or those who don't know much about you or Mindsprings. So if you could write the link or some information and your email ID in case if you would like to them to communicate with you, or how we can arrange for this
communication. I think they can send me their email IDs and I can kind of send it to them. And I put it always on social media. I'm taking a break, by the way, for a month or so, because I've been doing it for a long time now, 3 months. So when I come back, yes, if you guys haven't done it, you should. I think it's important.
Yes. And then I recommend
back it. And change schools, change the way your schools work. I think all of this that I told you is a huge change from the way you're working in the classroom.
And if you do like, ma'am, how you said. ma'am had given the title change audaciously. So please don't be apologetic about this change. This is needed fearlessly. Do it audaciously.
But must have the audacity to change.
This is the power behind this whole talk. What you said, if we are able to take that energy to change audaciously and break those dead habits.
Yes.
How absolutely. To convert these challenges into opportunities, ma'am has shown us very, very, very well. And on the Aadharshila platform itself, we can send you an email with details about ma'am and how you can know more about her courses. And ma'am, for me, is the Mindsprings teacher. I keep seeing her videos on YouTube. Please check that. Check for Mindsprings. And you will get a number of videos for teaching English, whether it is grammar or it is anything related to English. So I'm not an English teacher, but I love listening to her sessions, her videos. And I'm very conscious when I'm speaking today. I'm very conscious about the language. You know, as per ma'am's expectations or not. So I'll ask
for my report later. Jaya is a very courageous teacher. Jaya makes really strong decisions very quickly.
Thank you, ma'am.
But that's not very common, huh? So you should be, you should give yourself a pat. As they say.
So I must let you know, I didn't want to say it, but I must let you know that you are one of those people who have been indirectly influencing me. I follow all your posts on social media and I can see how audacious you are. And you know, that's
I'm very audacious. And,
yes.
In fact, I'm and so audacious that people are scared to call me.
I'm not one of them.
Yeah,
you're I'm not so happy that you came.
Many people are worried about what I might say.
That's okay. Because your last poem represents you. And this is how it should. We should relate to that poem and be like that. Live our life. Be true to ourselves first. Let us not say things which would please people. Be true to what we are meant for. Know our purpose as a teacher. So I think this was so wonderful, ma'am. Thank you very much for your time and for your wisdom. We have collected so many gems with us today. Thanks
ma'am, I've been attending Usha ma'am's training and this is the last week that I will do my assignments. It's amazing. I would recommend to everyone, each and every teacher, to go for this course.
Absolutely.
Thank you, ma'am.
All the teachers of my school have attended. Ma'am, just one last thing I would like the teachers from other schools to know. We have started using ma'am's books, textbooks authored by ma'am for our English courses. And we find them very relevant, very in sync with the way a child develops. Speaking, listening, reading, whatever. It keeps child at the center. This is what I would say. So if you have not explored, please explore her books. Those are wonderful books. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Hope to have you again with us sometime in the future, ma'am. Thank you so much.